Recorded Books and RB Digital present Kill Without Shame by Alexandra Ivy. Narrated by Jim Frangione. Prologue. The worst part of being held in a Taliban prison was the recurring nightmares, at least as far as Lucas St. Clair was concerned. No matter how many years passed, his nights were still plagued with memories of being trapped in the smothering darkness of the caves. He could smell the stench of unwashed bodies and undiluted fear. He could hear the muffled sounds of men praying for death. He knew his parents assumed that his biggest regret was the derailment of his political aspirations. After all, his military career was intended to be the first step in his climb to a position as a diplomat. From there, well, his family was nothing if not ambitious. They'd no doubt seen the White House in his future. But there were few things that could make a man view his life with the stark clarity of 5 weeks of brutal torture. By the time he'd managed to escape the caves, he'd known he was done living his life to please the precious St. Clair clan. Instead, he'd banded together with his friends, Rafe Vargas, a covert ops specialist, Max Grayson, who was trained in forensics, Hauk Lorentzen, a sniper, and Tegan Moore, a computer wizard, to create Aris Security. He'd wasted too much of his life. He intended to leave the past behind and concentrate on his future. Of course, there was an old saying about the best-laid plans of mice and men. Chapter 1. The saloon was the sort of bar that catered to the locals in the quiet Houston neighborhood. It was small, with lots of wood and polished brass. Overhead, there was an open beam ceiling with muted lights that provided a cozy atmosphere. And on the weekends, a jazz band was invited to play quietly on the narrow stage. Lucas spent most Friday evenings at the table tucked in a back corner. It was unofficially reserved for the 5 men who ran Aris Security. The men liked the peaceful ambiance, the communal agreement that everyone should mind their own business, and the fact that the table was situated so no one could sneak up from behind. Trained soldiers didn't want surprises. At the moment, the bar was nearly empty. Not only was it a gray, wet Wednesday evening, but it was the first week of December. That meant Christmas madness was in full swing. Perfectly normal people were now in crazy mode as they scurried from store to store, battling one another for the latest have-to-have gift. It was like Thunderdome without Tina Turner. Currently, Lucas and Tegan shared the place with a young couple seated near the bay window at the front of the bar. Those two were oblivious to everything but each other. And closer to the empty stage was a table of college girls. Already at the giggly stage of drunk, they were all blatantly checking Lucas out, at least when they weren't gawking at Tegan. No biggie. Both men were accustomed to female attention. Tegan was a large, heavily muscled man with dark caramel skin and golden eyes that he'd inherited from his Polynesian mother. He kept his hair shaved close to his skull, and as usual was dressed in a pair of camo pants and shit kickers. He had an aggressive vibe that was only emphasized by the tight T-shirt that left his arms bare to reveal numerous tattoos. Lucas St. Clair, on the other hand, was wearing a $1,000 suit that was tailored to perfectly fit his lean body. His glossy black hair was smothered away from his chiseled face, which he'd been told could easily grace the covers of fashion magazines. As if he gave a shit. His eyes were so dark they looked black. It wasn't until he was in the sunlight that it became obvious they were a deep indigo blue. Most assumed he was the less dangerous of the two men. They'd be wrong. But while the girls became increasingly more obvious in their attempts to attract their attention, neither man glanced in their direction. Tegan, because he already had a flock of women that included supermodels and 2 famous actresses. And Lucas, because he grimaced. To be honest, he wasn't sure why. He only knew that his interest in women hadn't been the same since he'd crawled out of that hellhole in Afghanistan. Not unless he counted the hours he spent brooding on one woman in particular. The one who got away. Lucas gave a sharp shake of his head, reaching for his shot of tequila. It slid down his throat like liquid fire, burning away the past. Nothing like a 12-year-old vintage to ease the pain. Lucas glanced toward his companion's empty glass. "Another round?" he asked. "Sure." Tegan waited for Lucas to nod toward the bartender, who was washing glasses, at the same time keeping a sharp eye on his few customers. "I assume you're picking up the tab?" Lucas cocked a brow. "Why do I always have to pick up the tab?" "You're the one with the trust fund, amigo, not me," Tegan said with a shrug. "The only thing my father ever gave me was a concussion and an intimate knowledge of the Texas penal system." Lucas snorted. It was common knowledge that he would beg in the streets before he would touch a penny of the St. Clair fortune, just as they all knew that Tegan had risen above his abusive background and temporary housing in the penitentiary to become a successful businessman. The younger man not only joined Aris, but he owned a mechanic shop that catered to a high-end clientele who had more money than sense when it came to their precious sports cars. "I might break out the violins if I didn't know you're making a fortune," Lucas told his friend as the bartender arrived to replace their drinks with a silent efficiency. "Hardly a fortune." Tegan downed a shot of tequila before he reached for his beer, heaving a faux sigh. "I have overhead out the ass, not to mention paying my cousins twice what they're worth. A word of warning, amigo. Never go into business with your family." "Too late," Lucas murmured. As far as he was concerned, the men who had crawled out of that Taliban cave with him were his brothers, and the only family that mattered. "True that." Tegan gave a slow nod, holding up his frosty glass. "To Aris." Lucas clinked his glass against Tegan's in appreciation of the bond they'd formed. "To Aris." Drinking the tequila in one swallow, Lucas set aside his empty glass. There was a brief silence before Tegan at last spoke the words that had no doubt been on the tip of his tongue since they walked through the door of the bar. "Are you ever going to get to the point of why you asked to meet me here?" his friend bluntly demanded. Lucas leaned back in his chair, arching his brows. "Couldn't it just be because I enjoy your sparkling personality?" Tegan snorted. "If I'd known this was a date, I would have worn my lucky shirt." "You need a shirt to get lucky?" "Not usually." Tegan flashed his friend a mocking smile. "But I've heard you like to play hard to get." Lucas grimaced at the direct hit. "Yeah, hard to get was one way to put it." "I want to discuss Hauk," he admitted, not at all eager to think about his lack of a sex life. Tegan leaned forward, folding his arms on the table. "Did you pick up any intel from your overseas contacts?" Lucas didn't ask how his companion knew he was quietly reaching out to his diplomatic associates in an effort to track down whoever was stalking Hauk. They were each using their various skills to discover who was responsible for leaving the creepy messages that were increasingly threatening in nature. "Yeah." He'd received an updated report earlier that morning. "There's been no chatter that includes Hauk or anything about our escape from Afghanistan." Tegan nodded. Each of them had managed to make enemies during their time in the Middle East. It was war. But Hauk was a sniper who'd received a very public Medal of Honor for taking out three powerful terrorist leaders during his time in service. That was the sort of thing that pissed people off. "Then this isn't the work of an organized cell?" "Nope." Lucas gave a decisive shake of his head. He'd contacted everyone he knew, including those at Homeland Security. If Hauk's name had been floating around as a potential target, someone would have heard it by now. "It's more likely some independent whack job." Tegan's jaw hardened with frustration. "I don't know whether to be relieved or disappointed. If it was a cell, we could keep an eye on them. But how the hell do we find some lone nutcase?" "I have word out that I'm looking for information on anyone who's shown an interest in Hauk." Lucas studied his companion's grim expression. "What about you?" Tegan reached for his beer. "I'm doing a computer search on anyone who served with Hauk during his tour in the Middle East and has left the military in the past 6 months." Lucas arched a brow. Tegan was talented, maybe even the best hacker in the world, but he wasn't a miracle worker. That's a long list. It's going to take a while, Tegan admitted, taking a deep drink of his beer. Shit, I hate this waiting. The thought that some unseen enemy was hunting Hauk was making them all twitchy. What about Max? Tegan slowly lowered his beer as his gaze narrowed. Did you forget to pay your taxes? Lucas frowned. What the hell are you talking about? Tegan nodded across the room. There's a government employee who just flashed a badge at the bartender and is now heading in our direction. Lucas glanced over his shoulder, his gaze trained on the middle-aged man strolling in their direction. The stranger had thinning blonde hair that looked like his wife had trimmed it, a suit that was in dire need of a good pressing, cheap shoes, and a face that had a hint of a bulldog in the features. Yep, definitely a government grunt. Lucas turned back toward his friend. How do you know he isn't looking for you? I'm too clever to get caught. Lucas rolled his eyes. Christ. Lucas St. Clair? Halting next to the table, the man instantly locked his attention on Lucas, which meant he knew exactly what Lucas looked like. So, had he recognized Lucas because of his ties to the St. Clair clan, or because he'd done a background check before entering the saloon? Lucas was betting on the background check. The stranger didn't look like the sort of man to take an interest in politics. Yes? The man flashed a badge that identified him as Houston Homicide Detective Sergeant Sam Cooper. I have a few questions for you. Lucas remained relaxed in his chair. There was no reason to get his panties in a twist. If there'd been a death in his powerful family, he wouldn't be contacted by a mid-level bureaucrat. And he hadn't killed anyone, at least not lately. Concerning? He asked. The man glanced around the nearly empty bar. Do you want to do this here? Lucas shrugged. Unless we need to include my lawyer. That won't be necessary. The yet hung in the air between them, and suddenly Lucas was a lot less nonchalant about the encounter. Narrowing his gaze, he nodded his head toward the chair across the table. Have a seat, detective. Waiting until the man lowered his solid form into the chair, Lucas waved a hand toward his friend, who glowered at the lawman with a menacing frown. This is Tegan Moore. Detective Cooper? Tegan muttered, folding his arms over his chest to make it clear he wasn't leaving. Lucas hid his smile. In his work as a negotiator, he'd learned the art of subtlety. It was easier to coerce people to do what he wanted rather than trying to force them. Tegan, on the other hand, was a sledgehammer. Returning his attention to the detective, Lucas tapped an impatient finger on the table. He had a dozen things he needed to take care of before he could return to his elegant townhouse in the center of Houston. Arras Security might be a relatively new business, but they were already swamped with demands for their services. And to make matters more insane, Rafe had taken off with his new bride to Hawaii for a well-earned honeymoon. Lucas wanted to be done with this cop so he could get back to work. You said you have some questions? He prompted. The man offered a self-deprecating smile, but Lucas didn't miss the cunning intelligence in his blue eyes. He was a man who liked to be underestimated. Taking the time to pull a small notebook and pen from an inner pocket of his jacket, Sam Cooper laid them neatly on the table. Precise, careful, meticulous. What's your relationship to Anthony Hughes? He at last asked. Lucas frowned. There is no relationship. I've never heard of... He bit off his words as an ancient memory floated to the surface of his brain. Wait, I went to prep school with a Tony Hughes. I don't know if that's the same guy. Where was the school? Lucas shrugged. Hale Academy in Shreveport. The detective's face remained impassive, but something flashed through his eyes that told Lucas they were speaking about the same person. So Tony is your old high school friend? Lucas hesitated. In truth, the two couldn't have been more opposite. He was the son of Senator St. Clair. He'd lived in a fancy mansion on the edge of town with a nanny, while his parents spent most of their time in D.C. On the other hand, Tony was the youngest of five brothers who grew up in a shack that had barely been habitable. If Tony hadn't been a 6'2" behemoth who excelled at football, he would never have been admitted into the exclusive private school. And even that wouldn't have made them more than classmates. It was only their mutual friendship with Mia Ramon that had thrown them together. "Not really," he said. "I haven't seen him in 15 years. Sam scribbled on his notepad, his gaze never leaving Lucas's face. "You're sure? He hasn't tried to call or contact you?" "I'm sure." Lucas felt a stab of dread. "What's going on? Is he in trouble?" The detective instantly pounced. "Why would you say that?" Lucas arched a brow. "Beyond the fact the homicide detective is asking me questions about him?" "Yeah, beyond that." It was no secret that Tony was doing drugs from the time he arrived at Hale, he admitted, not bothering to add that Tony was also dealing to make enough money to support his deadbeat dad. It wouldn't take much of a detective to dig up that old dirt. He was kicked off the football team when he tested positive for weed our senior year. If some unknown donor hadn't come up with his tuition, he would have been forced to leave school. More scribbling on the pad. "Were you close growing up?" "I didn't really know him until he transferred to the academy." "But you were friends?" "We both played football and occasionally hung out together." Lucas made a sound of impatience. "Are you going to tell me what your interest in Tony is?" "He's dead." "Dead?" Lucas blinked at the blunt response. Somehow he'd already leapt to the conclusion that Tony had been arrested for murder, and that he was now desperately trying to call in favors from the powerful acquaintances he'd acquired during high school. With an effort, he readjusted his thinking. "An overdose?" "He was shot 3 blocks from your office building." A stab of regret sliced through Lucas, even as he lifted his brows in surprise. "Tony was in Houston?" The detective gave a small nod. "He was." "Did he live here?" Sam Cooper shrugged. "He was carrying a Louisiana driver's license. We're checking the address that was listed." The air pressure dropped as Tegan leaned forward, his expression hard with annoyance. Despite his years in the military, the younger man harbored a deep distrust of authority figures. "Why are you here?" The detective turned his head to meet Tegan's glare. "Excuse me? If you have a body, shouldn't you be out looking for who made it dead?" Tegan demanded. "I find it's quicker to discover the killer when I know my victim." Lucas studied Sam Cooper. The authorities were clearly treating this as a targeted murder, not a random drive-by shooting. "Interesting. Then you came to the wrong guy," Lucas informed the detective. There was no point in letting the man waste his time. He felt bad as hell that Tony was dead, but it had nothing to do with him. "Like I said, I haven't seen or heard from Tony since high school." Sam Cooper ignored the unmistakable cue to bring the interview to an end. "Odd that he was shot so close to your building, don't you think, Mr. St. Clair?" "What do you mean, odd?" The detective shrugged. "You supposedly haven't seen Tony Hughes in years, but he manages to get shot just a few blocks away." "Enough." Lucas abruptly shoved himself to his feet, vaguely aware that Tegan was rising at the same time. "I've tried to be polite and answer your questions, but you're starting to piss me off." He held the detective's steady gaze. "Are you trying to imply I have some connection to this crime?" Sam Cooper remained sitting, remarkably nonchalant as both Lucas and Tegan glared down at him. Of course, they would have to be idiots to attack a member of the Houston Police Department in the middle of a bar. Plus, he was probably carrying. Hard to detect beneath the sports jacket that should have been burned in the 70s. "I think Tony Hughes was coming to see you," Sam said in a calm voice. Lucas scowled. "Why?" "Because of this." Reaching into his pocket, the detective pulled out a clear baggie and set it on the table. Lucas leaned forward to study the wrinkled piece of paper that had his name and address scribbled on it. "Where'd you get that?" he demanded. "Tony had it in his front pocket." "Shit," Lucas breathed in shock. "Still no idea why he was in your neighborhood?" "No." A chill inched down Lucas's spine. Why the hell had Tony been looking for him after 15 years? And who would shoot him on the street? Questions that needed answers, but not until he shook off the tenacious lawman. It was never a good idea to chat with a homicide detective when he had a connection to the dead body. And we're about to take this to my lawyer's office. About damn time, Deegan muttered. Sam Cooper lifted his hand, trying to look harmless. I just have one more question for now. What? The detective reached into his pocket to pull out another baggie. This one held a photo of a dark-haired woman with the words, "Kill her or else," scrawled across her face. Do you recognize this woman? Lucas reached to snatch the baggie off the table, holding the picture toward the muted light. He barely heard Tegan's low curse or the detective's protest at his rough handling of evidence. Even at a distance, he'd easily recognize the image of a stunning young woman. Oh, her features had matured from the soft prettiness of youth into elegant lines, and her body had filled out with curves that made his mouth water. But he'd recognize the thickly lashed dark eyes and soft, kissable mouth anywhere. His stomach was fisted with a dark sense of horror that wrenched the air from his lungs. Mia, he rasped. Mia? With a surge, the detective was on his feet, snatching the baggie from Lucas's fingers. Last name? Ramon. Mia Ramon, Lucas said even as he was turning away from the table. On some level, he understood that he wasn't thinking clearly. Shock did that to a man. But his primitive instincts didn't give a shit. All he knew was that Mia was in danger. Nothing else mattered. Wait, Detective Cooper commanded as Lucas headed toward the door. Where are you going? Lucas's long strides never faltered, not even when he sensed Tegan moving to walk at his side. What can I do? His friend asked. That simple. No aggravating demands for an explanation, just a sincere desire to help. Tell the guys I'm headed to Shreveport, he said, his subconscious making a list of tasks that had to be finished before he could leave Houston. I don't know when I'll be back. Chapter 2. Despite the chilly temperatures, the humidity in the air was the stuff of nightmares. Only in Louisiana could a person shiver with cold at the same time they were sweating like a dog. Entering the recently constructed brick building on the northern fringe of Bossier City, Mia barely resisted the urge to peel off the fitted black jacket that matched her A-line skirt. It wasn't just the fact that the expensive material was sticking to her skin. She always felt like a fraud in designer clothes. At heart, she was a jeans and sweatshirt kind of gal. Unfortunately, her corporate accounts expected the owner of Ramon Landscaping and Nursery to look like a professional, especially when they were expecting a normal, middle-aged Caucasian male to show up for the contract signing, not a 32-year-old woman with lush curves that regularly made men turn to watch her walk past. She'd already decided she would return to her small house just a mile down the road during lunch so she could change. For now, she was in dire need of a hefty dose of caffeine and a few minutes' peace. To say her morning had been stressful was like saying a tsunami was a little wave. With impeccable timing, Taylor Price rose from behind the reception desk to study her with open concern. The woman had been Mia's best friend throughout high school, and when Mia finally managed to stabilize her business to the point she could afford a full-time secretary, she'd pleaded with Taylor to leave her job as a waitress to help her. Mia might have a talent for creating a thriving business with satisfied customers and 5 full-time gardeners, plus another 5 part-time workers during the summer months, but she desperately needed someone to keep her organized. Taylor had been an answer to her prayers. The single mother of a 16-year-old son had taken charge of the office, along with keeping the employees on task with a brisk efficiency. Now she watched as Mia lifted her hand to pull out the pins that held her hair into a bun at the nape of her neck, releasing the glossy black strands to fall in a smooth curtain down her back. Crap, Taylor muttered, studying Mia's strained expression. You didn't get the contract. Mia managed a weary smile. She had worked for weeks to convince Fox Construction to accept her bid. Getting the contract meant that her crew would be in charge of landscaping the new subdivision being built near Wallace Lake. "It's signed, sealed, and will be delivered by Monday." "Sweet." Taylor tilted her head to one side. Despite having a teenage son, she looked like she was barely out of high school. She was as slim as a reed, with honey brown hair that she kept cut short and green eyes that could sparkle with amusement or flash with fury. She'd gotten pregnant by a local bad boy who'd taken off the second Justin was born, but that had never slowed her down. She worked, coached her son's baseball team, and took care of her aging mother, not to mention keeping Mia somewhere in the vicinity of sane. "So why do you look like you lost your puppy?" Mia rolled her shoulders, trying to ease the stiffness. "I'm sweating, my feet hurt. The owner of Fox Construction couldn't take his eyes off my boobs, despite the fact that they were covered in two layers of clothing. And some idiot nearly ran me off the road." She shook her head, her pulse still unsteady from the memory of the large SUV that had swerved into her lane, clipping her bumper. It was a miracle she'd avoided going into a ditch. "I swear, trained monkeys could drive better than most people." Taylor took efficient control. "What do you want first? Coffee or a maple cream donut?" Mia glanced toward the reception desk across the simply designed room with white tiled floors and walls painted a soft apricot. Currently, it was decorated with a large Christmas tree set in one corner and festive holly that was draped from the drop ceiling. Behind the office building, she'd constructed long sheds where she stored the equipment her landscaping company needed, and next door was a lot where she'd built rows of greenhouses. But in here, she'd demanded a hint of feminine charm. It was her eye for design that had taken her business from just another lawn mowing company to a full-service landscaping business worth millions. This morning, however, her attention was laser-focused on the full coffee maker and lovely pink box from her favorite bakery. "You are a saint," Mia murmured. "True." Taylor reached out to give her a light push. "Go into your office and put your feet up." Mia didn't have to be told twice. "Coffee? Donuts? A few minutes, peace. Priceless." Entering her office, which was decorated in the same apricot and white as the reception room, only without the Christmas decorations, she tossed aside her briefcase and eased herself into the chair behind her desk. Taking in a deep breath, she released it with a slow exhale, already feeling the knots in the pit of her stomach unraveling. Minutes later, Taylor bustled in, setting a large mug of black coffee and a massive donut on the desk. "Ah, bless you," Mia said, reaching for the coffee. "Any problems while I was gone?" Taylor shrugged. "When isn't there a problem?" "True. There were enough moving parts in her business, it was inevitable there would be daily disasters." "Hit me. Not until you finish your donut." "Okay, mother." Mia rolled her eyes, but she picked up the donut and took a bite. When Taylor put on her bossy pants, it was easier to do as she commanded. Savoring the sinfully decadent pastry, Mia at last wiped the sticky maple from her fingers and took another sip of her coffee. "Done," she said as she leaned back in her chair. Taylor reached for the crumpled napkin, throwing it in the trash before starting the daily list of glitches. "First up, the garage called and said they had to order a part for the flatbed." Mia nodded. It wasn't entirely unexpected. The flatbed truck was nearly 12 years old. Unfortunately, they needed to haul the larger pieces of equipment, and a new one wasn't in the budget until after the holidays. "How long?" she demanded. "Next week." "Call the rental company and tell them we'll need the truck until next Friday." "What else?" "Sonny stopped by to say that the Richardsons didn't pay him yesterday. They claimed they sent a check last week." Sonny had actually worked with her father mowing lawns and trimming hedges for the rich. Now he was her most trusted employee. "How far are they behind?" she asked. 3 months. Mia made a mental note. The Richardsons owned two small strip malls that were struggling to survive in the depressed economy. She'd tried to be patient. They'd once been a big deal around town, and it was possible they'd be able to refinance their business to avoid bankruptcy. But enough was enough. They would either come up with a payment plan or she would have to cancel their contract. "Tell him I'll deal with them," she promised. "Next." We added 3 new orders for Christmas decorations. "That's not a problem. That's fantastic news." Taylor planted her hands on her hips. "It was a brilliant idea, sweetie, but next year we're going to have to hire more help." Mia smiled. It had been her brainchild to offer a new service that would install Christmas lights and even decorate homes for a substantial fee. And it had been a startling success. The perfect Christmas was in high demand in the suburban, upwardly mobile, fancy homes. Thankfully, these homeowners had more money than time, which meant a lucrative profit for Mia. "See who's willing to put in some overtime, and make sure you schedule the work when I can oversee the project," she said. Taylor frowned. "Mia." "No lectures," Mia interrupted. She didn't need anyone to tell her that she worked too hard. Taylor rolled her eyes. "Stubborn bitch." "Anything else?" "Nothing that can't..." The chime from the front door interrupted the secretary's words. "Hold on." Leaning back, she peered out the open door, her lips pursing in a silent whistle. "Well, hello, tall and dark, and why aren't you in my bed?" she murmured. Mia chuckled. "You really have to stop ogling the customers." "Hey, I might have forgotten what my hoo-ha is used for, but that doesn't mean I'm dead." "Good Lord," Mia muttered, even as she ruefully acknowledged her friend wasn't the only one who hadn't used her hoo-ha for far too long. "Maybe you should see what he wants." Taylor ridiculously waggled her brows. "I can do that." About to step forward, the secretary halted, her smile fading. "You know, he looks familiar." "Who doesn't? This town is too small to..." "Shit." Mia blinked in surprise. Her friend was usually unflappable, so who the hell could make her hands clench into tight fists and her face flush with fury? "Taylor?" She rose from her chair. "What's wrong?" "I can't believe that bastard would show his face here." "Who?" Mia demanded. Usually, only Taylor's ex-husband could make her look like she was contemplating murder. Not surprising, the bastard periodically showed up in town, hoping for an easy handout from his ex-wife. Mia had tried to convince her friend to slam the door in his miserable face, but Taylor insisted that she never wanted her son to realize his father was a total schmuck. She would endure the visit for Justin's sake, even as she was no doubt wishing she could castrate the jackass. But while Mia tried to imagine who could be worse than Danny Price, the stranger strolled into her office. No, not a stranger. Lucas St. Clair. Slamming her hands flat on her desk as her knees threatened to give way, Mia studied the tall, dark-haired man. Disbelief shuddered through her. It had been 15 years since she'd last seen him in the flesh, but nothing had changed. He was still indecently gorgeous, maybe even more so. His features were more finely chiseled, emphasizing his male beauty. His hair was still a glossy black and smoothed from his face, and his body was honed with sleek muscles beneath his white dress shirt that he wore with the sleeves rolled up and pressed black chinos. He reminded her of a predatory cat. Sleek, lethal, ruthless. Even worse, the mere sight of him managed to set off the shivers of explosive awareness that no other man had ever managed to create. Damn him to hell and back. "Hello, Taylor," he murmured, ignoring the secretary's glare of death as he stepped toward the center of the office, his gaze locked on Mia's face. "Mia." Pain sliced through her heart. Once she'd loved this man with every fiber of her being. She'd been young and passionate and unable to contain her vulnerable emotions. Why would she? Lucas had made her believe they were perfect soulmates, destined to be together for all of eternity. Jackass. And then he'd left Shreveport to attend military school, and she'd been forgotten as easily as if she was something he'd scraped off the bottom of his shoe on his way out of town. "What are you doing here?" she said between clenched teeth. His lips twitched. "I'm fine. Thanks for asking. It's good to see you, too." good and seeing you again shouldn't be in the same sentence, she said between clenched teeth. Do you want me to get my stun gun? Taylor offered. Tempting, but probably not wise. Not yet. Mia's lips tightened as the phone abruptly rang. Will you get that, Taylor? For a second, the secretary hesitated, clearly wanting to zap the hell out of Lucas. Then, as Mia sent her an impatient frown, she held up her hands in defeat. Yeah, yeah, she muttered, heading out of the office. A few moments later, the ringing stopped, and Mia returned her attention to the man watching her with a disturbing intensity. She felt a burst of anger. Damn it. He didn't have the right to look at her like that. Not anymore. I asked you a question, she snapped. You look good, Mia. He stepped forward, his indigo gaze moving slowly down the stiff lines of her body. More than good. Her stomach clenched, tingles of anticipation racing through her blood, which pissed her off. What was wrong with her? She should be longing to kick him in the nads, not wondering how fast she could strip off his clothes so she could lick him from head to toe. I don't have time for this, she said. If you want to hire a gardener, I suggest you call one of my competitors. We only take care of commercial properties. He folded his arms over his chest, an unspoken warning he wasn't going to be easily dismissed. Ramon Landscaping and Nursery, he murmured. I'm impressed, Mia. I always knew you would make a success of yourself, but you've taken your father's small business and turned it into the beginning of an empire. A glow of pride filled her heart, even as she pointed toward the door. Morgan's mowing service is just down the road. I'm sure they'd be happy to help you. I'm not here for a gardener. We don't have anything else to discuss. She turned back toward the desk, silently willing him to leave. She was a strong, independent woman, but having Lucas standing so close made her feel vulnerable. Tony Hughes, he said softly. She froze before slowly turning to meet his grim gaze. Tony? You remember him, don't you? She unconsciously unbuttoned her jacket and shrugged it off. It felt like it was strangling her. And when the hell did her office get so warm? Had Taylor turned up the heater? Of course I remember him, but I haven't seen him in months, she said, tossing the jacket on the chair where she'd left her briefcase. If you're looking for him, he's dead. What? Mia blinked, suddenly feeling lightheaded as she swayed forward, straight into Lucas's waiting arms. Lucas tugged Mia tightly against his chest, briefly savoring the feel of her soft body and the sweet scent of honeysuckle. This was what he'd wanted from the minute he'd walked into the office. The sight of her had been like a punch to his gut, the regrets and aching need suddenly as raw as they'd been the day he'd driven away from Shreveport. At the time, he'd convinced himself he was doing what was best for Mia, best for both of them. Now he knew he'd been full of shit. He'd been a coward, and he'd paid for it every day since leaving this fabulous, passionate woman. But while he was happy as hell to hold her in his arms, he realized he'd been a jackass to share the news about Tony's death without easing the blow. Crap, I'm sorry, he murmured, running a soothing hand up and down the curve of her spine. I didn't mean to tell you like that. Mia! Taylor charged back into the office, taking in Mia's pale face before she was glaring at Lucas. What the hell did you do to her? It's okay, Taylor, Mia assured her friend, pushing her hands against Lucas's chest until he reluctantly allowed her to step back. Can we have some privacy? Taylor scowled. Are you sure? Yeah. I'm going to be at my desk. She deliberately glanced toward Lucas. Where I keep my stun gun. Just yell if you need me. Her warning delivered, the woman turned to leave the office, while Lucas chuckled. I've always liked her, he said with perfect sincerity. Taylor was fiercely loyal to Mia. He admired that in a friend. Mia shoved a shaky hand through her hair, her face still pale with shock. What happened to Tony? She demanded. Was he in an accident? No. Lucas grimaced. There was no easy way to say it. He was shot. She bit her lower lip.
A drug deal?
Ah, so his first instinct hadn't been wrong. Tony hadn't changed over the years. It's being investigated, he said. But the cops aren't treating it like a random crime.
God, this is horrible. She shivered. Why wasn't it on the news?
It happened in Houston.
Really?
Her brows pulled together in confusion. What was he doing in Houston? The cops think he was coming to see me.
You?
Her confusion deepened. Why would they think that? He had my name and address scribbled on a piece of paper.
You live in Houston?
His lips twisted. What had he expected? That she'd kept track of his career? Just because he'd remained obsessed with her didn't mean she was equally fascinated with him. Hell, she'd probably shoved all thoughts of him from her life years ago. I don't crawl beneath a rock every night, he said in dry tones. She hesitated, then cleared her throat.
I heard that you were,
she struggled for the word,
captured in Afghanistan. I'm sorry.
He stiffened. Of course, that would be the one part of his past she would know about. The part he never discussed. Not with anyone but his heiress brothers. I survived, he muttered. Easily sensing his discomfort, she backed away. Regretting his inability to accept even a polite show of sympathy for what he'd endured, Lucas swallowed a sigh. No one could understand, so there was no point in trying to explain.
Do you know why Tony was coming to see you?
No idea, he said with a shrug. I haven't seen or talked to him in 15 years. Is there any reason he'd be in Houston? She took a minute to actually consider his question.
Not that I can think of, she finally said.
His brothers have stayed in the area, and he never mentioned having friends or distant family in Texas. His gaze slid over her delicate features, the past briefly colliding with the present. It had been Tony who had brought them together. Granted, Lucas had caught brief glimpses of Mia on the rare occasions when she was helping her father during the summer. George Ramon had been the gardener for his parents, as well as several other families in the exclusive subdivision of Shreveport. But it wasn't until Tony had invited Lucas to a party deep in the wetlands that he'd finally had a chance to meet Mia face to face. He'd been stunned by her beauty. Hell, he was still stunned. With an effort, he forced himself to concentrate on the reason he'd spent the night tying up loose ends so he could leave Houston at the crack of dawn. Right now, nothing mattered but ensuring that this woman wasn't in danger. How well did you know Tony over the past few years? He asked. She gave a lift of her shoulder.
I hired him when he needed extra cash.
You always did rush to take care of the underdog, he murmured. Mia shrugged aside his soft words.
Unfortunately, last summer he was busted in one of my vehicles with a bag of weed.
Regret darkened her velvet brown eyes. She'd always had a soft spot for their mutual friend, even when he was acting like a complete idiot. I told him he couldn't work here anymore. He reached to brush the silky dark hair from her cheek, his body clenching at the feel of her warm skin. Thankfully, she was too distracted to notice that he allowed his fingers to linger. So you wouldn't know if someone wanted him dead? She flinched.
No.
Lucas squashed his instinct to back away from his questioning. Mia was still reeling from the shock of Tony's death, and in no place to discuss the gruesome details of why someone might have murdered him. But once again, he reminded himself that the sooner they found the killer, the sooner he could be certain Mia was safe. No ex-wife? He pressed. She shook her head.
Tony never married.
Girlfriend? Mistress? He paused. Secret male lover?
I didn't keep up with his private life.
She wrinkled her nose. It was a habit she'd had when she was young. He swallowed a sudden lump in his throat.
To be honest, I never saw him date anyone, she admitted.
Lucas frowned, trying to think back. It was true. Tony had always been the life of the party, and he'd occasionally walked off into the swamps with a girl, but Lucas couldn't remember seeing him with a steady date. Of course,
He hadn't really paid attention.
Odd, he muttered.
There was a short silence before Mia was sucking in a deep breath, as if trying to clear the fog from her mind. Then she studied him with a growing puzzlement.
Are you with the police?
No.
Then why are you investigating his death?
I want to know why he was coming to see me.
Her eyes narrowed. There was more than one reason why he had been fascinated by this female. Her beauty, of course, her passionate heart, and her incisive intelligence that had kept him on his toes whenever they'd debated an issue. There was something deeply sexy about a smart woman. Unfortunately, it meant that she easily sensed that he was keeping something from her.
And? She prompted.
And why he was holding your picture when he was shot, he grudgingly added.
That's exactly the question I was about to ask. The unexpected male voice intruded into their private conversation. Turning his head, Lucas cast a frustrated glance toward the intruder.
Who the hell are you? He demanded.
Detective Brian Cooper. The man offered a self-deprecating smile. I believe you met my uncle in Houston.
Lucas scowled, easily picking up the family resemblance to Detective Sam Cooper. The same dark blonde hair, although this man's was still thick and currently in need of a cut. The same solid body and bulldog features. He even had the same taste in clothing. An off-the-rack jacket, khakis, and cheap shoes.
Damn, he muttered beneath his breath.
Chapter 3 Mia frowned, staring at the stranger in confusion. She was still reeling. How was she supposed to process Lucas's startling appearance, followed by the news that Tony was dead? That didn't even include the last bit of information, that her old friend had been carrying a picture of her. Now she struggled to clear her fuzzy thoughts as she ran her gaze over the intruder. He looked harmless enough with his dark blonde hair, rumpled from the breeze, and his guileless brown eyes. Certainly he was handsome, but in an engaging, non-threatening way. At least until she caught sight of the gun holstered beneath his unbuttoned jacket.
What's going on? She demanded.
The man reached into his pocket to pull out a slender wallet. I'm Detective Brian Cooper from the Caddo Parish Sheriff's Office, he said, flashing his credentials.
Taylor muscled her way past the lawman, her face tight with frustration. First Lucas had snuck past her, and now this stranger. The younger woman was clearly in the mood to knock some heads together.
I'm sorry, Mia. I tried to stop him, she said through gritted teeth. He was very insistent. It seems to be a theme today, Mia muttered, trying to muster a smile for her friend. Why don't you make some fresh coffee, Taylor?
Waiting until her secretary had stomped out of the office, Mia turned her attention to her latest visitor.
I suppose this is about Tony?
It is. I have a few questions, the detective said, glancing toward the silent Lucas.
You'll excuse us, Mr. St. Clair?
Lucas folded his arms over his chest.
No.
The detective's jaw hardened, hinting at a ruthless temperament below his facade of just another good old boy.
That really wasn't a request.
Lucas gazed down his nose with all the arrogance that came from being born into a family that considered themselves a part of some superior species.
Aren't you out of your jurisdiction? Tony was murdered in Houston.
My uncle asked me to help with the investigation.
Tony lived here, after all,
the lawman smoothly answered.
It's important to retrace the steps of the victim. Now, if you don't mind...
I do mind, Lucas interrupted. I'm staying. Detective Cooper didn't budge. Suddenly, Mia's respect for him inched up a notch.
That's not up to you.
Lucas turned toward her, his expression impossible to read as he held out a hand.
Mia?
She
bit back her instinctive desire to kick him the hell out of her office. He hadn't been around when she'd needed him for the past 15 years, had he? But if she was being honest, she was still reeling from the thought that her childhood friend was dead. Right now, she'd take any support she could get.
Yes.
She reached out to allow him to wrap his fingers around her hand.
I'd like for Lucas to stay. Something flared through the deep blue of his eyes.
Thank you. Detective Cooper thinned his lips, but he seemed to decide this wasn't a battle he was willing to fight.
Very well.
He glanced toward the desk. Do you want to have a seat?
She shook her head, just wanting to get it over with. No.
Tucking away his badge, the detective pulled out a small notepad and pencil. Then, with a smile that was intended to put her at ease, he began asking her the usual questions. Mia answered with as much information as possible. Yes, she had known Tony since grade school in Bossier City. Yes, they stayed friends despite him going to a fancy prep school across the river in Shreveport. She admitted they'd briefly lost touch after high school, but that she'd hired him when he showed up at her door 5 years ago. She also admitted that Tony had been caught with weed and she'd fired him the past summer. Then Detective Cooper's questioning became far more pointed. Did she have a relationship with Tony? Did she have any enemies? Mia unconsciously shifted closer to Lucas, allowing his heat to combat the chill that was shivering through her body.
I think that's enough, Detective.
Lucas immediately took charge, his arm wrapping around her shoulder to pull her tight against his side. Ms. Ramon has had a shock. If you have more questions, you should speak to her lawyer.
Lawyer?
Mia blinked in shock, for the first time realizing there might be more to the detective's visit than to gain info on Tony.
Do you think I'm involved?
Mia, she interrupted Lucas's protest.
I want to know.
Detective Cooper reached into the pocket of his jacket to pull out a photocopy of a picture. We found this clutched in Tony Hughes's fingers, he said, holding it out so Mia could see the enlarged black and white picture. Her stomach clenched as she recognized the image of herself walking into the office building, with the words, "Kill her or else," scrawled across her face.
What the hell? Tony had this?
She breathed.
Yes.
She lifted her gaze to find Cooper watching her with a piercing intensity.
Why?
That's what we intend to find out.
The detective nodded toward the photo. Do you know when this would have been taken? She licked her dry lips.
No, but it had to be within the last few weeks.
How can you be sure?
The construction on this building wasn't finished until the end of October.
Cooper tucked away the photocopy and scribbled in his notepad.
Was Tony angry that you fired him?
Not really.
Mia abruptly stiffened, belatedly realizing what the man was asking.
Wait, you can't think that Tony wanted to hurt me.
It's one possibility.
Enough. This time there was no mistaking the authority in Lucas's tone. Any further questions will be asked in the presence of a lawyer. The detective flashed Lucas a glare of frustration before sliding his pen and paper in his pocket and pulling out a business card. Then, smoothing his expression, he cast Mia a reassuring smile.
I'll be in touch, he murmured, handing her the card with his name and number printed on it.
Call me if you think of anything, no matter how small. You'd be surprised how many cases have been solved by a clue that was initially dismissed as inconsequential.
You don't think he was killed because of a drug deal?
She demanded, unable to imagine Tony involved in anything more sinister than an encounter with a pissed-off junkie. Her old friend might have been a burnout who'd wasted what little potential he'd possessed as a jock, but he'd never been involved in serious crime.
I like to keep an open mind, Detective Cooper said in non-committal tones, giving a nod of his head. Ms. Ramon?
St. Clair? She was vaguely aware of the detective leaving the office, and even the fact that Lucas was staring at her with an increasing concern, but she was lost in a heavy sadness.
Poor Tony.
He'd come from a crappy family who'd barely noticed he was alive, unless he was on the football field. He'd never managed to find a purpose in life, or at least none that he'd shared with her. For the first time, she realized just how private Tony had been. Oh, he was always up for a party, but he'd never truly shared his thoughts or feelings. She didn't know any more about him than she had when they were both 6 years old.
Mia. Grabbing her by the shoulders, Lucas turned her to meet his worried gaze. Talk to me.
With an effort, she pulled herself out of the dark hole that threatened to suck her in.
"This doesn't make any sense," she said,
forcing herself to concentrate on the questions buzzing at the edge of her mind. She couldn't change her friend's death, but maybe she could help catch whoever was responsible, and at the same time, figure out who the hell had written that horrible message on her photo.
Why was Tony in Houston, and why did he have a picture of me?
I don't know yet, but I promise I'll find out. She stilled, studying his grim expression.
You said you weren't working for the cops.
I'm not. A fierce smile curved his lips. I'm better. She rolled her eyes.
I see you haven't lost any of your arrogance, she muttered.
It's not arrogance. It's fact. Stepping back, he reached into his pocket to pull out his wallet. Extracting a gold-embossed business card, he pressed into her hand. Mia read the elegant lettering with a lift of her brows.
Aris Security?
It's a company I started with a few friends. Trust me, we have the expertise and technology to find out exactly what Tony was doing. Mia's lips parted to demand what had happened to his career as a diplomat, only to hastily swallow the words. There was no way in hell she was going to reveal her seething interest in what he'd been doing since he'd returned from the Middle East. He'd cut her out of his life. So be it.
Why?
She instead demanded. His brooding gaze slid down to the stubborn tilt of her chin.
What do you mean? What's your interest in any of this?
Tony was coming to see me, he said. I want to know why.
And that's the only reason?
No. Reaching up, he cupped her face in his hands. I'm here for you, Mia.
Aris Security had chosen to open their business in a newly constructed office building in an upscale Houston neighborhood. The faded red brick building with large windows and ornamental molding looked more suited for a financial service or a law firm. But Lucas had wisely argued that the sort of customers who would be able to afford their highly exclusive services would be comforted by the feel of old-world charm. It was a theme that was carried through the large reception area and front offices. The carpets were plush ivory, the walls were darkly paneled, and the furniture made of sturdy wood with crimson cushions. The hushed atmosphere, however, was decidedly absent on the top two floors. The second floor was dedicated to the high-tech lab where Max Grayson worked his forensic magic. The top floor had been claimed by Tegan. Unlike Max, who liked to work in brightly lit rooms with white-tiled floors, Tegan preferred to keep the curtains pulled to protect his equipment. The series of darkened offices were filled with sleek computers, four separate servers, and a line of monitors that kept constant watch on the companies that hired them, as well as the area around their building. They were still hoping to catch the bastard who was leaving Hauk threatening notes. At the moment, Tegan was settled behind his massive desk, wearing a Henley that was tucked into a worn pair of fatigue pants, and his feet were covered by a pair of motorcycle boots. Entering the office, Max gave a slight shake of his head at the sight of the empty pizza boxes tossed in a corner and the garbage can filled with beer bottles. No one, not even the cleaning staff, was allowed in Tegan's private space.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.